Veterans Day ceremonies. First, I'd like to have the invocation by Bill Gray.
You ran through the streets like you missed it.
Life is brief. Time is such a precious thing. We should value every minute and bless the world with kindly deeds. The short time we live in it, live each day to its very fullest. But as we know, we never know when it will be our last. In everything, there's a reason. In each day, there is a season. Amen.
Amen.
That was a day off, and you marched up U.S. 11 when it was permissible, and then you marched up the hill, and we came down here, and you formed up, and there was a Founders Day celebration. And when that was over, you had the rest of the day off. Many times it was a beautiful day like today, and you boys would go on the back roads and go over to the river and maybe take the first swim of the year. It was on May the 8th, and I'm not sure exactly the date, but it was around in the 1880s, that my great-grandmother came into the classroom and said, "Boys, we're going to have a holiday today to celebrate the boss's birthday." And so that's how Founders Day came to be.
William O. Brubeck, Francis C. Harris, Thomas J. Hughes, Jr., Henry F. Jocks, Clyde L. Kinney, Frank Litton, William Shepherd, Hammond H. Snyder, Edward M. Pryor, James Lewis Pryor, Henry R. Harris, Edgar Allan III, Harold Kep. I might not have pronounced that right. It's either Kep or Klep. Wade Hansborough, Jr., Ernest Bosco, Joseph Richard Payne, Bernie L. Tobacco, Fenton D. Somerville, Ralph W. Halsinger, Charles W. Carnan, Jr., Billy Haycock, William Rob Nichols, Harry Ray Roberts, Charles K. Payne, John O. McMillan, George W. Jones, Burgess U. Whitehead, E. Lee Trinkle, Jr., Robert Louis Wilson, Leslie Charles Pollock Shomo, Martin G. Mance, Jr., Preston C. Hodges, Stephen Timberlake, Francis A. Howard, Charles W. Switzer, John E. Dudley, Morris Lepowitz, and the wife of Will Parkins, passed on February the 1st, 96. The bugler will now play taps. Those in uniform will please salute. Those who are not will place their right hand over their heart.
Saluting all of the AMA cadets who wore their country's uniform in the times of great danger. And as our president, Gary Nicholson, has said, The fellows who went to Korea and Vietnam did not come home to brass bands and ticker tape parades. Korea is the forgotten war, Vietnam the nightmare of the late 60s. And we in this room want every one of you to know that we consider every AMA cadet who was in uniform during any of these conflicts to be genuine, unsullied heroes. Homage tonight to the Augusta men to whom death came too early. They that did love and were loved. And here in this school were reared. For us, for their country, for the world, went hence into life everlasting. In the Korean War, First Lieutenant Riley Rhodes, United States Army, AMA class of 1947.
Down in the field of honor, sir.
In the Korean War, PFC Gloyd Rosen, Jr., United States Marine Corps, AMA class of 1951.
Down in the field of honor, sir.
In the Vietnam War, PFC Neil Mac MacIver, United States Army, AMA class of 1961.
Down in the field of honor, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome everyone here today for our Founders Day ceremonies. First of all, I'd like to have the invocation given by Bill Gray.
Bow your heads, please, and nose with hats on, please remove. Sir.
That's all.
Oh, that's wonderful cooperation. Dear Lord, if we've gathered here to pay respects to the founder of this wonderful school, may we all say in our silent way, may they rest in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Naturally, we're here today to honor our founders, and I'd like to have Mickey Gordon come forward, please.
He's hiding somewhere.
Mickey? Mickey's going to tell us about our founders. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
May 3, 1997, Augusta Military Academy Alumni Association, Special Order Number 1, Founders Day. Founders Day was always celebrated on May the 8th. It was not the founding of the Academy that we have known. It was the birth date of the founder of the Academy, Professor Charles Somerville Roller, who was born on the 8th of May in 1839 and died in 1907. He had his early education, he was born here in Mount Sydney. He had his early education in the central Shenandoah Valley at the Parkins Classical School and later the Mossy Creek Academy. Then the young Mr. Roller went to the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. I don't know whether he saw Mr. Jefferson. He would not have. But he went over there in 1859. And after several years as a student at Charlottesville, and with the outbreak of the Civil War, he joined the Confederate forces. He served with E Company, 1st Virginia Regiment, which was attached to General J.B. Stuart's cavalry. After the war, he returned to this area, and it's brought to my attention he had two prime interests, education and politics. The educational part, he recognized that so many of the young men who served with the Confederacy during the war had missed their 1, 2, 3, 4 years of education. He was interested in seeing if they could recapture some of those book learning years. He was also interested in the reconstruction of the valley here, some of which was reduced to rubble. He went to Richmond in 1871. He served in the state legislature for 2 years, returning here in 1873, after which what we know as the Augusta Military Academy was originally formed. To the best of my ability, the year 1874 could or should be the origin year, the first year. He founded a school in this area in 1874, and they named it the Augusta Male Academy. Still AMA, but it was the Augusta Male Academy. And in its first year, it had 43 young men from this area enrolled. In 1890, the academy's name was changed to the Augusta Classical and Military Academy. And sometime prior to the turn of the century, the name that you and I know, the Augusta Military Academy, was adopted. Professor Roller's wife was named Rosabelle Judith Mormon. She was from Lynchburg. They were married when the school was in its infancy. And they had 4 children, 3 boys and a girl. I know of a half a dozen of us here that knew all of these children. It was Dr. William C. Roller, he practiced medicine. He was the school doctor. There was Colonel Thomas J. Roller and Major Charles S. Roller, Jr., who were our co-principals. And it was Maggie Bell Robinson, who was married to Major Boots Robinson, Warren Boots Robinson, who was our algebra teacher. As earlier stated, Founders Day is the birthday of Professor Roller. And we don't know exactly when that Founders Day holiday was created, but it is said that the manner in which it was created was one day on his birthday in class when Mrs. Professor Roller went into class and explained, "This is your birthday. You and the boys ought to have a holiday." And from that time on, Founders Day has been a holiday. Some of us, again, the small group of us in attendance, and those who were here in the 20s and 30s, there was an old saying that every dog has its day. Major Jake's was the 8th of May. Major Jake was Major Herbert Jacob. He was the assistant commandant. And he served the academy for more than 30 years. And on that day, battalion would form over on the blacktop, Major Jacob leading the entire battalion with his sword. We'd march down here to the Valley Pike, up the pike, into the cemetery, right to this area where we are now, the band playing Armed Christian Soldiers, and there would be a ceremony honoring Professor Roller. After which, the battalion would march back to, we had a police escort. Holding traffic off so we could march up the highway. We were really big time in those days. And after the ceremony, we'd go back to the barracks. There are no classes that day. Cadets were given liberty. They could go into Stanton. They could play games. They could sack in, play athletics, whatever. that that was a national holiday for the cadets. As it says on Major Roller, General Roller's stone back here, as the shadows lengthen tonight, the sun will set on an empty barracks. But your memories will soar with you for an eternity. Goodbye. Goodbye, Professor Roller, Colonel Tom, Major Charles. Dismiss.
Thank you, Mickey.
Also, at this time, every year, we unfortunately read a list of taps. Something we don't like to do, however, we must do it every year. Bill, Gray, come forward.
I hope you all can hear me. I want to read this poem that was sent to me. It's titled, Prayer of a Soldier. When bitter grief is soothed by years, and a time has dried a loved one's tears, then may you never more forget that peace must still be fought for ye, that evil's power must ne'er again be suffered anywhere to reign. For this, then let my spirit live if I must stay. We're gathered here to pay our respects to many former cadets of AMA. We're now enrolled in that spirit army, which football calls no sound. Mr. President, I will now call the roll. I will just give names. Alan Presley, Edward Lindsay Doyer, Albert C. Wagner, Gus M. Hyman, Jack Moulton, his widow, Dorothy Achilles, George B. Ferber, John L. Lay, Jr., Dr. Paul Morshall, Frank J. Quartin, Stephen Mark Spiegel, Frank Turley, William S. Phillips, Jr., Lester Higby, Sr., Noble Edgar Byrd, Jr., Henley H. Neiman, William Lewis Adam, Paul H. Hartwell, John Seven, Donald Thomas, William H. Cuddle, Edward Blaine Noel, James Jim Stilwell, Edward Francis Haley Jr., Robert F. Demer, Thomas Reamer Wallace, Frederick W. Lemley, Nathaniel Mitchell, Robert F. Foley, Bill Ann Guthrie, Ernest M. James, James W. Fontaine, James Weldon Grove, G. Robert Mariner, Mrs. Arella P. Miller, William Buddy Cole, Ed Darty, John Franklin Trotman, John P. Manor, Julian Mann, Alfred Chambers Ray, Marcarlio Laracala, I think I pronounced it right, Francis J. McGreath, Agnes N. McGreath, Lloyd Jack Koch. We did not have a bugler today, but I would appreciate if everyone just bow their heads for a moment of silence to those who have gone. May those former cadets rest in peace. Amen.
He was forensics, 10th through 12th grades. He's on a national Latin exam, 2 silver medals, 3 and 4. His SAT score of 1540, and only missed one question. One question. Governor
Governor School, the Massanutten Regional Governor's School before the 11th grade, the Central Shenandoah Valley Regional Governor's School, 11th and 12th grade, the Virginia Regional Residential Governor's School before 12th grade. He will be attending the University of Virginia School of Engineering and Computer Science.
I would like to thank all of you, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank all of you, ladies and gentlemen, for your contributions to my college career through your having provided this scholarship. I never had the opportunity to go to Augusta, obviously, but I grew up with AMA and AMA values all around. My father, my Uncle Ernest, my cousin Rod Willie, my hero Bob Bradford.
You gotta go low sometimes.
My friends Mal and Linda Livick, my Sunday school teacher Mal Livick Jr., have all impressed upon me the virtues of AMA. I know there must be something special about a school that will bring back its graduates to reunions like this over the years. You have here tonight schoolmates from 1932, from California to Florida to New England to the Virginia Islands. Virgin Islands. All right. Yeah, pretty close. Just to bring back memories of a treasured experience y'all had so long ago. Well, maybe not so long ago. I hope that the educational experiences ahead of me, those experiences that you helped make possible, will make me feel the same way about my school and my classmates years from now. Thank you.
Faculty member and the Augusta County School Superintendent, Ed Clymore, for a few comments. Coach?
Gary, thank you very much. I can recall, as Gary was standing up here trying to get order in here, I can recall an exercise that occurred on the blacktop out front of AMA on numerous occasions by the first captain and officer in charge. It was something like locking your heels, making a left face and double timing around the bowl. I'm really glad to be here and have your attention this evening. It's the first time that I have seen many of you since I left AMA, and it's certainly a pleasure to be here, and I congratulate you and the leaders of the AMA Alumni Association for having such an excellent banquet. As I was getting off the elevator, just memories are flooding back, and dinner may be a little bit late if I get on a roll. I'm sorry, but I was getting off the elevator, and here was I started to say a young man, not so young anymore, but someone towering over me, looking down and saying, "Coach Clymore, do you remember me? What are you going to say?" "Yeah, yes, I do." As he broke my hand, he said, Willie Walker said to me, "Do you remember taking a paddle and..." He didn't say wearing me out. He used a couple of other adjectives. And thinking to myself, trying to think rather quickly, I said, no, Willie, that was Mal Livick that did that. Willie said, no, that was you. He did it also. Again, I'm delighted to be here for three reasons: to reacquaint myself with many of you and to congratulate you as an association. It's great to see so many. Willie, David Click, I'm very proud of David as a product of our school division. He will make an outstanding leader, as many of you all have. So David, my congratulations. I appreciate the Alumni Association making this award, and believe me, you made it to a fine young man. Secondly, I'm pleased and congratulate you on honoring Mal and Linda Lavick. I greatly appreciate that. That school was their life, surely, and they have been not only contributors there, but they've been contributors in this community for many, many years. And I congratulate you, Mal and Linda, and I express my appreciation to the Alumni Association for recognizing the leadership that he gave over these many, many years. So I truly appreciate that. I have some experiences with him. If I begin, dinner would be greatly delayed. I didn't know what his name was for a long time. I thought it was Captain Midnight or something like that. Yeah, he got me on a kick of going to bed at 10 o'clock, and I'll tell you why. He kept me up so many, many late nights out there. I stayed in a barracks one year, and he wouldn't come over till about 11 o'clock at night. He'd come by my room and say, come on and go with me. What for? Just come and go with me. We're trying to catch some kid pulling a weed over in band barracks or something, and I'd be out with him. I finally looked at him and said, look, this has got to stop. I got to teach class. You'll drag in here about 11 tomorrow. And anyway, ever since that experience, I've been at 10 o'clock to bed, and if I don't shut up, we're not going to bed till after 10 this evening. Final reason that I'm here, and I'm going to ask Mal Lavick to come up and join me with this, is to make a presentation. It's my honor to do so. We want to honor a fine young man, a graduate of Augusta Military Academy, a contributor on his job, a contributor within our community. And secondly, we want to rectify an oversight that occurred some 30 years ago. And as former baseball coach there, I feel that I can do it, and I wasn't the baseball coach at the time. Bill Parkins, if you don't mind, I'd like to have you come up, please. Yeah. Due to an oversight, Bill participated on the 1969 and 1970. You just stand still and I'll not make you come to attention. I might in a minute, but anyway. Bill participated on the 1969 and 1970 baseball team. At the end of the year, he was ill, and as I said, there was an oversight at the time, and he failed to receive a letter, just strictly an oversight on several of us's part. And being the person that Bill is, he never did say anything. I found out about it last year, called attention to it to Mal, and we both decided at this particular banquet, with Gary's consent, that we would like to rectify that and present Bill with a letter from the Augusta Military Academy for the year 1970. Appreciate the opportunity to be with you.
This year we have a gentleman with us from the class of 1932. It's the first time he's been back to a reunion in 65 years. Ben Chiswell, would you please stand? Mr. Chiswell. California. from California for this reunion this year.
I can still stand, don't I?
Next, we have people from the 1937, their 60-year reunion. Would you please stand, 1937. 1937. Reunion from the class of 1947. Would you please stand? 1947. And our 40-year reunion from the class of 1957. 1957, please stand. Say this, guys. 30-year reunion, class of 1967. Yeah. Back. And for their 25th reunion, class of 1972. Class of 1977. 77, would you please stand? Now, one other thing, would all the past first captains please stand? All the past first captains, please stand up. Over to Bob Raft for the rest of the program this evening. I'd like to present to you your president for the next year is Goodlow Saunders, class of 1957. Goodlow. Vice President Bob Radford. Bob. Secretary Clyde Ramsey, if he's here. Clyde.
Clint was sir.
Okay. What's new? And our treasurer, Ed Click. Ed. And our chaplain again this year, Bill Gregg. Bob, I'd like to turn this over to Mr. Bradford. Bob Bradford, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm a first past captain. Does that count? I guess not. I want to thank everybody very sincerely that helped out with the history project that you did in the last bayonet. A lot of people did a lot of work, and your name is in there, but one person that didn't get mentioned quite enough is Ed Click, because Ed did a lot of the research and helped me write that story, and I really do appreciate that. I didn't tell you to stand up, I just said thank you.
Thank you for the knife.
No, goody. I also want to thank all of you for the comments about the bayonet. Everybody has told me here that what they like best about the bayonet is the fact that it has class notes in it. It has stories in there about other alumni. Well, guess what? To everybody else, everyone in this room is an other alumni. And if I don't hear from you, if you guys don't tell me what you're doing, if you don't send me news, I won't have anything to write. And so I would very much appreciate it if those of you who picked up forms during the meeting would turn them in. And if you go back home, I'm sure you've done something exciting recently. You must have done something exciting recently other than come here. And so please let me know about it so I can pass it along to the other guys. I'd like to note also that when this dinner is over, we're going to try to get pictures of the honored classes. We got 47 last night when they had a few more people here. But 37, 57, 67, 72, and 77, after dinner, we want to try to get pictures. I'd also like to confirm that the Ad Astra breakfast is 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. And I am very happy at this time to present your next president of the AMA Alumni Association, who's going to come up now for a very special presentation. Good luck.
See you here.
Amen.
Don't you forget, you better be here next year as well, so we can have a nice dinner and get together. I have the honor tonight to make two presentations. So I would like Susan, if she would come up first. Now I'll tell you a little bit about this. Behind every good man, there's a solid lady. Okay? Well, I want to tell you, all you have to do is to look at her and see which one over the past 4 years did all the work. She has got to be 3 inches shorter and 75 pounds lighter. I mean, just look at her. If you want to find all of that, just look over there in the corner. And I also want to tell you that all of you have been eating very well for the last 2 days from the compliments of... What room were you in? She doesn't know. She doesn't know what room she was in, but it was a kitchen in that room. Don't tell Holiday Inn. And she provided food for us for the last couple of days. And I want to tell you, my pants don't fit. Because I have been eating for the last 2 days like it's going to stock because it's so good. But I want to tell you what, the last 4 years, Gary has needed all the help he could get. And he could not have had a better partner, a better friend than this lady right here backing him up all the way. And we are the benefits of that. The only guy's pants that fit tighter than mine are Gary's. Come on up, you big boy. By the way, Tuesday night, Weight Watchers, 7 o'clock. He has been pinging on me for the last 2 days. Ah, it's going to be your time. I'm all done. I've done my job. I don't know anybody who would take on this organization's for 4 years, and the man hadn't even felt good, you know? I just don't understand. But I want to tell you one thing, that most of us would not be here, we would not have this crowd here, if it wasn't for Gary. He has worked. I mean, he's been through negotiations and negotiations and negotiations from hell. He has sold the school 3 times to only be given back to him 4. He is still trying to sell the thing, and he's just in negotiations again. I told him, I'm not doing it. I don't know how to do this. Anyway, during that time, he was ill, and he persevered, and that darling wife of his took care of him, and he kept right on going. He didn't quit and give up, and that, to me, tells me that's a real person that all of us would like to think we are. And we are going to miss him. I'm going to miss him. I want to tell you what, I have got the biggest shoes to slop myself around in of anything, any time that I have ever taken over in my entire life. I've done it a few times, you know, taking over commands and things, but this is the most awesome one, and you all really need to give him one of the nicest standing ovation that anybody in this world deserves.
I've been here and I've done this and I've done that, but I couldn't have done it without you guys. If you weren't here, it wouldn't mean anything. It wouldn't mean a thing to anybody. The only thing I say is thank you, and I'm going back on the board of directors, and I plan to continue to work for you guys and keep everything running as best I can with their supervision. Thank you very much.
Very much, Gary and Susan. It's been great working with both of you, and I look forward to many more happy times together, particularly when you're out of town, Gary. She's a real nice lady. So Nancy and I love Susan and Gary, and I hope it's reciprocated. And next year, Nancy's promised me she's going to come along because my parole officer can't come next year. So folks, I hope that at this point you would give a big welcome back to Ray Hoster and the Stanton Ovation, who treated us to a musical treat last year. Colonel Thomas J. Roller and Major Colonel General Charles S. Roller, Jr. There are two of them. Linda, beloved granddaughter, who called him Daddy, and Mal, given the task of filling unfillable shoes. Linda and Mal, Colonel and Mrs. Livick, would you please stand? We're so glad you're with us tonight. And we were very sorry that Hilton couldn't be here tonight. And Virginia, we're so glad that you could be here with us tonight. So thank you. Would you please stand? What a privilege we in this room have, folks. We have memories of our Augusta that no one else on God's earth can fully fathom or rightly esteem. Our heritage began before the nation began. The Old Stone Church was an educational institution. The first minister was brought there not only to serve God, but to provide an education for the young men in the area. And sometime after the church was founded in 1740, there was a school in the grove next to the church. And AMA's founder, Charles Somerville Roller, the professor, the old boss, probably attended the school in the mid-1800s. And there likely was the flame kindled that led him to devote his life to educating young men here in the great valley of the Shenandoah.
Oh, Shenandoah, I long to see you.
Smiling.
Life was bucolic in the Shenandoah Valley 150 years ago. Transportation and contact with the world beyond were limited. But the late 1850s brought sounds of discord. Our nation, created barely 80 years earlier, was on the verge of disintegration. In 1861, Virginia left the Union, and in 1863, Charles Roller joined the Confederate cavalry to serve under General Jeb Stuart. The Civil War raged for 4 terrible years, bringing to the Valley all the hideousness of that terrible struggle. On the 8th of April, 1865, a 26-year-old soldier in Company E, 1st Virginia Cavalry, was wounded at a place called Appomattox. The next day, in this quiet Virginia village, Charles Roller and 12,000 other weary Confederate soldiers lay down their arms. The Civil War was over. But in Virginia and much of the South, the devastation was nearly complete. Soldiers came home to burned homes and barren fields. But 2 returning soldiers saw instantly that Virginia and the South could never expect to recover their places among the states unless the young men in those states were educated. Robert E. Lee went to Lexington in 1865. Where he struggled to keep Washington College, later Washington and Lee, from closing. And 45 miles away, in Fort Defiance, Charles Roller began tutoring Confederate veterans. By the late 1870s, the Augusta Male Academy was in operation. Professor Roller taught, and Linda believes that Mrs. Roller probably cooked for the students who were there at the time. There were 55 students by 1887, and AMA played its first football game that year. And by then it was Augusta Military Academy, although Professor Roller never wore a uniform after Appomattox. As the century ended, Professor Roller's health began to deteriorate, and he called on his two sons to come home. Tom Roller was teaching classical language at a prep school in Memphis, and Charles Roller Jr. was teaching and coaching football at Furman University. Home they came. The professor died in 1907, and the brothers, Tom, or Colonel, and Charles, or Major, began their incredible stewardship toward destiny. Guns roared again, this time across the Atlantic. As America entered World War I, the brothers decided that one must go off to battle and the other would stay and run the school. And so Charles Roller went to France as a captain in the ambulance corps until the First World War ended in November of 1918.
Such a lad.
Tell your sweetheart not to cry.
To be proud of the boys in line.
Over there, over there. Send the word over there. And the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drums drum drumming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word, send the word.
From the towns and the tanks.
Make your old man proud of you.
And the old red, white, and the blue.
Over there.
Wonderful music from the Stanton Ovation, ladies and gentlemen. Augusta sent more than 500 of its alumni to World War I. 9 AMA boys did not come back. After the armistice, Augusta continued to grow. How many in this room were cadet waiters? How many of you were CWs? Okay, great, great. All the CWs, stand up if you can. Cadet waiters were introduced at AMA in 1919, and what a wonderful opportunity so many guys were given by the foresight of the Roller Brothers. But then came the Great Depression. Colonel Tom's daughter, Hilton, remembers what difficult times those were for the school. Colonel and Major went on the road to recruit students, trying to convince poor and penurious parents to send their boys to school in the shadow of the Blue Ridge Mountains. Here may disagree, but Ray Hoster is the hardest working guy in the room tonight. This gentleman right here, who's leading the Satin Ovation. Don't do that, there are children here, Ray. Once more, the war drum sounded. The great World War II began. Augusta had more than its share of heroes, and 52 AMA boys died too young. Among them, they amassed 3 Bronze Stars, 4 Air Medals, 7 Silver Stars, and 2 Distinguished Service Crosses. When the war was over, boys who had gone away came home men. And in World War II, they knew what they were fighting for.
Yeah.
I've been asked to lead the next chorus, but we'll wait for that for just a few moments. It's my honor tonight to provide some words pertaining to Thomas Jacob Rowland. Before I start that, I'd like to qualify that it's my understanding also, most of you can agree, that the human mind is a very detailed computer that works constantly until you get up to say something. Thomas Jacob Rowler was born on the 19th of December in 1877 in Fort Defiance. He died on the 10th of March, 1946. He graduated from the Augusta Military Academy in 1895. He went to the University of Virginia. He was the co-principal and the headmaster of the Augusta Military Academy. Amo, Amas, Amat. I love, you love, he or she loves. Anyone in this gathering who took an AMA diploma obviously took Latin, a required course, probably from Colonel Roller. Colonel Roller and his wife Virginia lived in the lovely home Beaumont, just off the bowl at the campus. They had two children, Hilton Roller Somerville Grasty, who unfortunately cannot be here this evening. She anticipated being here. Her daughter is here in her behalf. And there was she had a younger brother, Thomas A. Roller, who was first captain of the cadets my first year at AMA. Colonel Roller, or the Colonel, was referred to as the Colonel. I don't think that Major Roller was necessarily called the Major. He was called many things, but not just the Major. But Colonel Roller was the Colonel. There was only one Colonel, the Colonel. The Colonel was the second of three sons, and there was a sister that was born to Professor and Mrs. Roller. It was Dr. William Roller, Major Charles, and Maggie Bell, who was married to Major Robinson. Colonel Tom went to the university after graduating from the Augusta Military Academy. He returned to Augusta one year later. He graduated, as I said, in 1895. He came back in 1896 when he was here as an instructor in the Romance languages. He was teaching Latin, German, and French. 5 years later, in 1901, he went back again to Charlottesville, taking postgraduate courses. As Bob mentioned, after that tenure of learning, he received a wonderful opportunity to go to the Memphis University School in Tennessee. He remained there until 1905, when the failing health of his father, Professor Roller, encouraged him to come back here to AMA. And when his father died in 1907, the Colonel discarded any aspirations he had had up to that time of pursuing a law education. And he and his brother Charles, Major Roland, they assumed the leadership and became co-principals of AMA. Colonel Tom's responsibilities was that of headmaster, the administration, the business manager, the teachings, the courses. Major Roller became the commandant of cadets. He was in charge also the athletics, and both of those gentlemen were teachers on our staff. And it's apparent that neither of them ever seemed to invade the territory of the other. The school flourished, it grew. The big barracks was built in 1916. The enrollment surpassed 300. It was the largest ever at that time, 300 in 1929, when the market crashed, the depression came in, it played havoc with AMA. The enrollment was reduced down to but 177 in 1934, and tuition fees, which had been at $1,000 in 1932, were reduced to $850. And the rural families had to mortgage their homes, their land, their other properties, up to the limit, just to retain control of this academy that we loved. I understand there was a special meeting at one time with the faculty when it was explained in very plain language. Those faculty remained during the depression, they were told, we will give you room, we'll give you board, and if we have any money to pay you, when, as, and if, we'll pay you that way. And it was also during this period of time in the 30s that during this crisis that the roller farm performed so adequately for the school. Most of the meats, the produce, all came from the family's farm. And I know there are at least a dozen of us in this room. I'm seeing you nodding, Captain. There are at least a dozen of us in this room that can remember that taste of spring onions in the milk that we got every day. Colonel Tom loved to travel. He liked to hunt. The Jersey Shore in the summer with his family was one of his delights. He also liked to travel, take his family up to Martha's Vineyard off of Cape Cod. And he liked and appreciated fine clothes. He had a personal shopper in Manhattan. And he would shop for clothes for his children and for his wife and for himself. And I'm led to believe that there were big boxes, crates of clothes would be sent down from the finest stores in Manhattan. Your mother liked this. She told me about it. And he was also a practical joker. I don't know this, this is hearsay. But the colonel, I'm told, when he'd have house guests or some relatives would come to stay in the home, it wasn't beyond him to set up a couple of pulleys outside of his room, outside of the guest room, and he'd tie some pots and pans to the portion outside of the guest room, and after they'd go to sleep at night, and during the middle of the night, whether he was going to the bathroom or he just woke up anyway, he'd take outside of his room and he'd yank this, and the gosh darndest noises would occur. And the next morning when the guests would say, we don't know whether that was a storm or what, there were some animals or something out there, and Colonel Tom, supposedly with a straight face, he doesn't know anything. Perfectly, he didn't hear anything. Now he may have learned some of that. That may have developed when he was a cadet himself. No, you're laughing. This is the truth. I have here a copy. I took this out of a book. I came into possession a couple of years ago of a demerit book from the year 1893 to 1894. Don't laugh too much, because I've got you on here too. You're a grandfather. Your grandfather. But on the page for Roller Thomas J., just let me read part of it. Just part of it. These are some of the demerits he received, the reasons for demerits. Communicating across tables. Absent from reveille. Buttoning coat after the command fall in. Visiting during study hours. Absent from reveille. Absent from reveille. Late for reveille. Communicating during study hall. Absent from reveille. Absent from reveille. Now, incidentally, Roller W.C., the doctor, and Roller Jr., they were also, all your family must have been late for reveille. That must be a habit in the family. Okay. Like I said, he was a very well-respected man in the community. Colonel Roller served on the board of directors of the Stanton National Bank. He was president of the board several times, twice. He was also the founding director of the Augusta Rockingham Bank. One of the officers that he served that he was particularly proud of, and on two different occasions, he was the chairman of the National Association of the Military Schools and Colleges. There were more than 100 military schools such as ours and military colleges. And twice, Colonel Roller was the chairman of that national group. He was also active in the local tent of the Saints and Sinners. The word character, not in a derogatory way, but having character is what I want to try to emphasize at this point. Colonel Thomas J. Roller had character, and my interpretation of character is kindliness, understanding, and loyalty. Colonel Tom was kind to all, the needy as well as those not in need. He was definitely a friend of youth. He dedicated his life to teaching. He understood the troubles of his students, and he sought to understand, to learn their limitations and their desires. And he was loyal to his God, his country, and the traditions and ideals of Augusta Military Academy. Colonel Roller was a gentleman.
To follow. I don't have any papers because I'm supposed to talk about Charles Somerville Roller Jr. I always think of him when someone mentions the name Charlie Roller. I never called him Charlie Roller. I never knew his son, also known as Charlie Roller. Bob and I, in our correspondence, we refer to them as CSR1, CSR2, and CSR3 to try to keep straight who is doing what to whom. But I'll have to tell you that I am an unabashed admirer, practically a worshiper, of Charles Somerville Roller, Jr. I came to AMA when I was 12 years old. He had a profound effect on me. I knew him as many students did not, sort of as an accident. My brother and I were work boys in addition to the cadet waiter system that they had established to help boys work their way through school. There were the work boys who cleaned the classrooms and did various sundry other things that needed to be done, including helping in the mess hall that on the big holidays we got to do things that the CWs didn't want to do and could push off on us. It was easier with me because I was about so tall. But anyway, my brother and I attended at the same time, and the two of us were going to AMA for about two-thirds of the going rate, and in addition to that two-thirds of the rate, he had my mother there as the nurse in the infirmary. So I got to know him fairly well. And one of the things that I did every day was I had to report at the end of the sixth period. We had only six at that time. And I had to help close the big room. And he, of course, was there, and this was the end of his academic day. And every day we would walk down the aisle of the big room, usually with his arm around my neck, and it was sort of like leading a bear. He would tell me the things that he thought I ought to know, and he thought I ought to know a lot of things. I am a local boy. My family, of course, and his family were crossed paths a number of times. They're buried up there right across on the other side of the lot from the Rollers. I had a great uncle who taught at AMA, and we've had a long sort of joint history, which he knew much more about than I did. And he used to tell me about the history and about my family, that which I did know and didn't know. He explained it all to me anyway. It didn't really make much difference. Now, I never thought of Major Roller, Colonel Roller, General Roller. I knew him as a colonel. I never thought of him as being malicious. I always thought of him as being the original irresistible force. Now, he wasn't unmovable because you could get in there, you know, and slobber and whimper a little bit. And you could get around almost anything if you really, really, really had been a good boy and you were really, really sorry. You could get away with a bit that way. But he loved a manly man, and he had his own definitions of what that would be. So I'll try to give you a little bit of a sketch of what I think of when I think of Charlie Roller. He was a coach at Furman. Steve Pearson dug this one up off the internet. An official who was coming down to officiate at a football game for Coach Roller was detained and unable to attend, so Coach Roller was the official. There was not one penalty called for the whole game. At the end of that game, whether it ran to full time or they ran out of players, I don't know, but the two schools gave up competition for a number of years because they just couldn't do that anymore. I can remember his coming in and telling us things about the his visits to Fort Meade and going to Richmond or Washington, and he would go into some government office and say, "I'm Colonel Roller from Fort Defiance." And they didn't know who he was. I mean, he might be like General Halftrack, you know. He might actually have troops out there somewhere that he could bring in. But he truly believed, as I think of Abraham Lincoln and his what he would do to save the Union. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to save the Union. Well, Charlie Roller was going to keep AMA going. It didn't make any difference what it took. If it was his, if it was somebody else's, whatever he needed to do that was honorable, he would do to keep Augusta going. And it just really didn't bother him very much how he went about these things and how much of his personal effort he had to expend. I really felt sorry for the people who had to take over from him, because in addition to this enormous force that's wearing everything, knocking everything else out of the way, he kept no records. He would come back at the end of the day, and the money that he had picked up that was supposed to be used for some particular purpose would be gone, because he would have bought a load of wood to have sent to widow somebody or other, or he would have done this or that or the other thing with the money, and he'd come back and Will Parkins was supposed to make it all right. I know that when the GIs came back on the GI Bill after World War II, he was really upset that he didn't get the checks. The checks are supposed to come to me. It's my school. Well, no, that's not the way it works. Major, I guess he was that. That's not the way it works. The checks go to the individual, and then they pay. Well, that's not the way it ought to be. These people don't really understand. It should come to me because it's my school. He gave you a lot of flack about that, didn't he, Will? He had a tremendously affable personality. He knew people. People liked him. People admired him. He was George Catlett Marshall's roommate at VMI. And he never hesitated to call on people who might be able to help. Cy McHugh, most of you, I hope, certainly those of my generation, all knew Scientific Cy, the mechanical guy, who taught physics, right? Well, Cy wanted to go in the Army during World War II, but he couldn't right at first, and then they decided that they would take him, and they called him away. Well, Major Roller was not going to take that one sitting down. He wrote to his friend, and he said, "I want to know how you expect me to maintain this school and the tradition we have of training military officers when you take the best I have and put them in the service where they're just wasted." And of course, this friend was George Catlett Marshall. He was the chief of staff of the U.S. Army. I mean, he was it. He was the War Department. Cy never knew anything about this until after the war. He came back and he went to visit that thing that Leslie Groves had built, the Pentagon. And he decided he'd look at his records, and sure enough, in his file, there's this record from Charlie Roller to George Marshall saying, "What are you doing with my boy? How can you expect me to keep on doing this?" He had an incredible memory in addition to his audacity. I had a letter from Edward Carlin of the class of 1935. I don't know if any of you remember him. He was a professional singer, lives in Roanoke, and he had gone away and made a career for himself, and he came back to AMA some 20 years after his graduation, and he said, "There I was 20 years older, about 40 pounds heavier, lost most of my hair, and I said, 'Do you remember me, Major?' And he looked at me and said, 'You're Edward Harris Carlin of Galax, Virginia.'" But he could do that. Audacity, I said. He had audacity. He had pet peeves. He hated cigarettes. Worse than rattlesnakes. I have seen him walk up to a patron, a mother of one of the cadets, and take a cigarette out of her mouth and grind it out on the ground right in front of the assembled corps. And I don't recall anybody ever saying, "You can't do that." Because he could. It was his school. One of the shocking things about Augusta is the fact that this was a privately owned, a family-owned school. And unlike the others, if you look at the history of the academies of Virginia, you find out that almost all of them were associated with some church. Augusta was not, although the ties with the Stone Church were fairly close. But they did it themselves, and as far as Charlie Roller was concerned, he pretty much did it his way. And it was a very, very difficult act to follow. But I loved that old bear. I truly did. And they have a saying down in Texas, where little Red Harris is from, and he loved Red Harris too, because he let him get away with stuff that he should have been kicked out of school for. But Harris's grandfather had been his roommate at VMI, and you never go back on a friend. And down in Texas, they have something that the Rangers say about you can't stop a good man in the right who keeps on coming. Now, I won't say that Charlie Roller was always in the right, but he always thought he was right. And I loved him for it. He was a great man. He's the most unforgettable person I've ever met.
Jim Mitchell, class of 1976. I'd first like to thank Porky for giving me the opportunity and the honor to give this tribute to Colonel Ivick. Initially, I felt kind of funny giving this speech. As all of us, I started as a private, worked my way up to first sergeant, and I graduated as a private. I kind of had a rags-to-riches-to-rags story. And if I were given this speech 20 years ago, depending on what semester I was in, I think Colonel Lyak would have liked to grab one of the old 0383 Springfields and come after me. But luckily, Colonel Lyak never came after me with a gun. And I was fortunate enough to graduate from AMA. Since my years at Augusta, I've continued a wonderful relationship with Colonel and Linda Lyak, their children, and their grandchildren. To this day, as some of the cadets present in this room will attest, when we see Colonel Lyak, we stand a little taller, hold our head a little higher, and pause a moment to give him the first chance to speak. I guess this is maybe what you could call respect. I have many vivid, colorful, and cherished memories of AMA, and I'd like to share one of them with you. One night, when I was first sergeant, Scotty F. and Lieutenant Larry London and Master Sergeant Eddie Long, we all decided to take a beer run to the IGA in Verona. Well, we jumped on the railroad tracks, went down and got our cases of beer and filled our orders, and I went over and called Barbie the cabbie at the phone booth. We came back and we started getting a little nervous. Cabbie hadn't come. So I went back to the phone booth, and when I went back to the side of the IGA, all my boys were gone. At that moment, the big yellow Chrysler rolled in. Colonel Lyak. I dove over the side of the embankment, and I heard the car door open up, and the steps walked up, and looking right above me were two pair of feet hanging over the ledge. He was surveying the railroad tracks to see where the boys had run. I could have reached out and touched them, but at the time, I thought it was a better idea not to. I'm finally coming clean, Colonel Lyak. Well, Colonel Lyak sped away, and at the same time, Barbie the cabbie pulled in. We loaded up the beer and dashed back to the end of the cemetery next to Bellwood. I stashed the beer and tore off the barracks as reveille was sounding. I climbed in a bathroom window of C Company and popped my head out of the sinks, and there was Colonel Tominski, the battalion commander at the time. And he began to inform me that they knew the whole story and marched me off to the commandant's office. He swung the door open, and there sat Colonel Lyak. I used the bad judgment that night of going when he happened to be OC. And he decided to call an impromptu tattoo. And as was usual, he did know the whole story. I walked in and he said, "What do you have to say to yourself for yourself, Mitchell?" And I said, "Well, Colonel, if I tell you everything, could you go a little easier on us?" And he says, "Well, it couldn't hurt you right now." At that point, I pulled my fatigue jacket open and pulled four Michelobes out of my belt. Set him down on the commandant's table. He looked at the bottles of beer, shook his head, and just kind of looked up at me, waiting for another reply. I said, "Well, Colonel, if I tell you everything, the almighty, all truth, would you go easier on us?" And he said, "Jim, this time, I don't think it could get much worse for you." At that, I pulled the Velcro off my two sleeves and swung out two more Michelobes out of my sleeve and plopped them down on the commandant's table. Colonel Lyak looked at him, shook his head, looked up at me, and he said, "Well, Jim, all I have to say to you is you got good taste." Well, Colonel Lyak, I might have good taste, but I also have beliefs and values that you help instill in me at AMA. Values such as honor, integrity, hard work, and strength of family, which were readily displayed by you and your wife, Linda. Colonel Lyak's fabled speeches reaffirm these values, and these same values I try to instill in my children today. Colonel and Major Roller were heroes and icons to all of us, and I treasure their legacy. But Colonel Leivick, you were flesh and blood to me, and you were and continue to be one of the single most influential people in my life. Your vision of AMA is instilled in me, and a week does not go by where I don't reach back and reflect on my experiences at AMA to deal with life's current ups and downs and trials and tribulations. Thank you, Colonel Leivick, for helping me become the man that I am today and the Americans that my children will become tomorrow. Colonel Leivick and Linda Leivick, I salute you.
Do you have your speech prepared? And I said, no, I'm not going to say anything. He says, well, what kind of superintendent were you? I said, well, probably not too much. But Jim, it's been so good seeing everybody, as it was over the years, as we attempted to organize the Alumni Association when the school was in existence and running. And it was always a great time of the year in the spring when everyone came back and we saw a lot of the old fellows, old in years at AMA, young in spirit, who would come back. And I want to take this opportunity to thank all of you, those of you who really worked hard to help the school survive. It didn't. But Linda and I appreciate all that you did to try to help it to survive. Thank you for this evening. And wait a minute, Willis. At ease. This afternoon in the cemetery, and then later as I've turned around, I keep running into fellows who have come back who were cadets during my time at Augusta from 55 on, except for a couple of years until several years before it closed. It's been delightful seeing each one of you. It's delightful making new acquaintances of those we haven't had the opportunity to meet before. And just thank you all for being here and helping the spirit of AMA to survive.
Why not treat you?
fortunate few who can call ourselves Augusta men, what a glorious company we do keep. One of our own won the Pulitzer Prize for his novel and the Oscar for his movie. One of our own won the first ever Lombardi Trophy as the outstanding college football lineman in all the country. One of our own flew from the pitching deck of the aircraft carrier Hornet to drop the first bombs on Japan in World War II. And let me take this opportunity to welcome Lee Manch, whose husband, Jacob Shorty Manch, AMA class of 1938, co-piloted a Mitchell bomber on the famous Doolittle raid on Tokyo. Lee, would you please stand? One of our own rescued the King of Belgium and his family from the Nazis in World War II. One of our own was one of the last Americans to die in the Korean War. One of our own was one of the first Americans to die in Vietnam. One of our own has been nominated four times for a Pulitzer Prize in sports reporting. One of our own is a bishop. One of our own owns a clothing store. One of our own is an admiral. One of our own spent 6 weeks in Uganda performing surgery on children who were thought to be hopeless. One of our own is a general. One of our own built a church. One of our own spent his career in the military and then turned his brilliant mind to teaching people in prison. One of our own won a Silver Star in World War I for eliminating a German machine gun nest. One of our own is a policeman. And one of our own was in a German concentration camp all through World War II. One of our own became a father for the first time last week. One of our own became a grandfather in March. That was I. One of our own became a great-grandfather last October. One of our own became a great-great-grandfather last June. So as the line goes back to Charles Somerville Roller, to Colonel Tom, to Major, Colonel, General Roller, whatever your generation, and to Hilton, and to Mal in Virginia, so does it go forward in the hearts of people here tonight and here in spirit. It goes on through our lives and beyond as we relate our Augusta memories to our children, and their children. You know, the simplest two-syllable words sometimes can provoke the most consequential and heartfelt memories, a virtual tsunami of emotions. I want you to think with me for a couple of minutes about some two-syllable words and phrases, each of which evoke recollections so personal and so sweet that try as we may, we can't fully share them with anyone. Now listen. Big room. Roller. Parade. Savage. Finals. Hoover. PX. Leivik. Mess hall. McHugh. M1, Springfield, Parkins, Tattoo. There may be a barrier across the front gate, but in my mind and in my heart, as I'm sure it is in yours, AMA is alive. I can hear the bugle sound reveille. I can hear the bell ring in the mess hall. I can see the corps sweep by in studied cadence. And I know that what we had can never fade nor die. The memories will last until there are just two of us left to share them.
evening with the Armed Forces songs. And when it's yours, you stand up, okay?
Yeah.
Thank you all for coming. You are dismissed. One, two, three.